Hey everyone, welcome to the second part of our lecture on the first week of media and popular culture. So today we made it through our discussion of the work of art in the age of mechanical reproduction in the first part of this lecture, and in the second part we're going to discuss Paul Duguay. Well, we'll begin by discussing Paul Duguay and the article "What is Culture?" So Duguay begins by citing Raymond Williams, who's a really well-known scholar in communication, and he traces sort of the history of the term culture. And he says, you know, the term originally was associated with the idea of tending crops, right, to cultivate crops, culture, cultivate. You could see that they have the same root. You know, over time it evolves. So from there we go to this idea of culture as the process of human development. Then with the coming of the Age of Enlightenment, we see culture begin to be used to contrast European progress with what we might call less civilized, in quotes, societies, right? So this is clearly problematic in some ways, but nevertheless, right, this is how the term was used. Then in the 19th century, we see the rise of nationalism. And as a consequence, what happens is that the term culture becomes associated with the way of life that's practiced by groups. And this is the way that a lot of us still think about culture today. So when we talk about, when we talk about media and culture, for example, or we talk about, people in a certain culture or subculture have certain practices, rituals, traditions, and so on, what we're really talking about is a way of life that's practiced by a group of people. Now, I have a note here to myself to detour into the notion of imagined communities. And so the idea of imagined communities was pioneered by a scholar by the name of Benedict Anderson, who was exploring the idea of the rise of nationalism during the 19th century and thereafter. And it's interesting to recognize that the whole idea of the nation state has only existed for a couple hundred years. And so, you know, what Anderson was doing was he was looking at this and he was saying, you know, well, what is a nation? You know, for example, what is the United States of America? And it's hard to say because the United States is such a big place, right? Like, what do I, you know, a 50-year-old guy living in Atlanta have in common with a 12-year-old Inuit Eskimo girl living 100 miles outside of Anchorage, Alaska? Well, the answer is not much, but we're both Americans. So what makes us Americans? Well, you know, in theory, we probably both pay taxes. There's certain sets of federal laws that we have to obey. But besides that, there's not really a lot else that makes us Americans. Right? There's the founding constitutional document that endows us with certain similar rights. But again, beyond that, in terms of the way we see the world, in terms of our lived experience, the way that we experience our lives, right, is very different. And so Anderson says, you know, at the end of the day, the nation is really kind of an imagined community. And the stuff of this imagining, I submit to you, according to this 19th century definition, is culture. The ways of life practiced by different groups. All right, so from there, we get into the late 19th century where it becomes associated with intellectual refinement. And this speaks to the high-low dichotomy, high art, low art. Right. So when we talk about culture now, you might think about an art museum or about the symphony or something of the sort. We say that someone is very cultured if they're very highbrow and this kind of thing. And so that's sort of another way of understanding what culture means. So we move on then into the 20th century, and what we find is the definition is associated with the rise of the social sciences and begins to emphasize the relation of culture to meaning. So in this regard, we talk about culture and meaning to the extent that culture and meaning are intertwined. Your culture affects how meaning is made. Where you grew up, the traditions, practices, and beliefs of the people in the community surrounding you influence then how you make sense out of the messages that you receive. Right? So, you know, your background, your environment, all these things impact the ways that you make meanings out of the various messages that you receive, be it on TV, on your iPad, from politicians, from newscasts, from newspapers, from magazines, right? It's all influenced by your culture. And for Williams, the social definition of culture is a description of a particular way of life that expresses certain meanings and values. And they're not only expressed in art and learning, but also in institutions and in ordinary behavior. So one way of thinking about this is there is, in some real sense, a kind of American culture, let's say. And that is then influenced, right? Influences the sort of the way you make sense of the world. Because there are all kinds of meanings that come with these traditions, practices, and institutions that influence the way you perceive the world. In other words, your culture and its institutions influence your way of seeing. I mean, this is, of course, in part why you're at college. Why are you at college? Well, because you got to go to college to get a good job. That whole idea is a product of your culture. It's not even necessarily true. It's helpful to go to college to get a high-paying job, but you certainly don't have to do it in this day and age. Nevertheless, you're here, right? And so that value, right, influences your behavior and it influences the way you see the world. And so in some real sense, then, we come to this point, which is that your way of seeing is also your way of living. And your way of seeing is influenced by your culture. And so it becomes kind of a circle, right? The way that you see the world influences the way you live in the world, which in turn influences your society and culture, which in turn influences the way you see the world, you see. And it's this big circle of reinforcement. And so this leads then Duguay to say culture ultimately is the giving and taking of meaning. Right? We share meaning and we receive meaning. All is part of this big circular system of reinforcement that we engage in. So despite all this, I mean, this all probably sounds pretty good, but there's still a bunch of questions we can ask. Isn't there more than one way of life? How do we even make meanings? Do we all share the same meanings? Do we share different meanings? And which groups share which meanings? What about counter meanings? What about groups that don't go along with the quote-unquote cultural ideals? Do those exist? If they do, where do they circulate? Who shares these ideas? How do they share them? What kinds of meanings can we all agree on, and what meanings do we disagree with, right? Which, in other words, what meanings are being contested? And then, at the end of the day, if someone in the culture doesn't agree with a certain set of meanings, then how does that reflect the play of power in society? In other words, who's in charge of making the meanings and distributing the meanings that influence our way of seeing, that influence the way we live, that then influence our society, which influences our way of seeing, right? Like, you know, who's responsible for all this? And so there are all these kinds of questions. So as a result, you know, keeping all this in mind, Duguay tells us, you know, that we can't just read off culture from society. We can't just look at our society and get an idea of what the culture is. Instead, we have to pay attention to what he calls the symbolic sphere. And so here, he's talking about things like signifying practices. And signifying practices are the ways that we behave that convey meaning. So ultimately, all social practices are signifying practices. They're meant to send a message, right? And at times, even if it's not the intention to send a message, you're still doing it, right? And so here are some examples. I mean, clearly, these folks down here, you know, they're dressed up in their KKK robes and carrying Confederate flags. This is signifying practice. They're sending a message. I mean, one that I'd say is quite hateful. Nevertheless, they're sending a message. And they're not necessarily doing it through language or through writing. They're doing it through a practice, through a physical act, and they're doing it through clothing. They're doing it through their demonstration, right? And the same sort of thing, believe it or not, is happening up here in this top photo. You got this long-haired hippie kid with his 420 shirt on, smoking some pot, right? And that's all a form of expression. That's sending a message. I'm a stoner. I'm countercultural, right? Like, I'm peace, love, man, right? I mean, it's a very different message than what the folks down here are sending. But nevertheless, what he's doing by smoking pot, by wearing those clothes, by growing his hair long, those are all forms of communication. You're sending out a message. And a lot of times we don't think about it that way. A lot of times we're just like, oh, man, this 420 shirt's awesome, right? And you wear it. But you're sending a message. And you know, if you think about it even briefly, you know, at any kind of depth, that you're sending a message. And this is a signifying practice that goes beyond what we've written and the messages that we put together in the media and send out. And so this is what Duguay is saying, right? You can't just look at what we've written. You can't just look at what we've painted. You can't just look at the institutions, you have to look at the practices, the way that meaning is expressed through actions. So, what we're dealing with then is meaning and systems of representation. So, Duguay goes on, he says, you know, language can be understood as any system of representation, photography, painting, speech, writing, imaging through technology, drawing, etc. So it's not just writing. It's not just writing an academic article or making a political speech. It could be a picture. It could be a painting. It could be your clothing. It could be the way you wear your hair, right? So language is more than just words. Language is the use of a set of signs or a signifying system to represent things and exchange meaning about them. So for Duguay, he'd say, listen, those KKK robes and those hoods, that's a language. Right? And it's a language that these folks are doing to send a message that they're hoping other people will pick up. And in other words, they're exchanging meaning. Right? And what's interesting about meaning is that it exists in chains. Right? So in other words, not that it's bound, but rather one meaning follows another meaning. And one understanding is built on a previous understanding. So he says, we map new things in terms of, or by extension or analogy from, things we already know. And this is a really kind of insightful, if commonsensical, kind of understanding of learning and the expression of ideas and the creation of meaning. You know, you start off by learning a few words, and then you build on those words. And then you build on those words, right? Until you can read books. And then you understand more. And then you read more books. And you understand those books based on ideas that you picked up with the books you read before, which ideas are based on the words that you learned before that, right? You see how this works. All learning and understanding and meaning is built through chains. And so in some sense, each meaning leads back to another meaning. And this is not just the way learning works, it's the way society works. It's the way culture works. It can all be traced back. After a while, you know, if enough history and time goes by, sometimes we lose track of where we were and we lose track of where a meaning or a practice originated. But that doesn't change the fact that meanings are built off of other meanings, right? So if I write an academic paper, it's going to be based on other papers and other ideas that I've read, which were based on other ideas and papers the people who wrote those papers read, and so on and so forth back to the beginning of time. If you want to think about it, I mean, this is a film class. If we want to think about it in terms of films, right? If you go watch a Western, there are all the generic tropes and conventions and expectations you have when you walk in there. You know, you expect the good guy to wear a white hat. You expect there to be a shootout, that they carry six guns, that they're going to be horses, that there are going to be scenes in a saloon. And all that meaning, excuse me, is based on every other cowboy movie from that genre that you've ever seen. And so this is what Duguay is getting at, is that within culture, every meaning is based on previous meanings. And this all exists in a chain that, in theory, you could trace back to the beginning of people, I suppose. So he says, as cultural beings, then, we are all always irrevocably immersed in this sea of meaning that we call culture. So what's happening is, you know, there are all these people sharing meanings, particularly today, be it on the internet, you know, social media, billboards, advertisements, websites, magazines, newspapers, televisions, right? There are all these meanings that are being shared. And then on top of it, in cities, you have all these people walking around in their different clothes and different hairstyles, sharing their signifying practices, sharing meanings. You're sharing meaning with people at work. And so as a result, you can never get out, right? You can never be free of the culture that makes us interpretive beings. Our culture surrounds us. There's constant sharing of messages. And the meanings that we make from these messages are based on our context, where we are. Which leads me to the question, is meaning always relative? And, you know, I don't know that I have an answer for you. This is an age-old philosophical question. This is what philosophers have always looked for, right? Is some kind of universal truth. And it's so hard to pin down that people have been doing it for, you know, 2,000-3,000 years. All right, so that does it for Duguay. So let's move on to Fisk. So Fisk here is talking about culture, and in particular, he's talking about popular culture. Okay, so we began this unit by talking about media in terms of art, right, and how art changed with the Industrial Revolution and technological reproducibility, meaning the printing press and photography and films and all that, right? So we talked about media. Then we talked about culture with Duguay, and we traced the history of culture. And we talked about culture as it relates to meaning. And now with Fisk, we're going to talk about popular culture. So we're covering the elements of the class, right? Media, culture, popular culture. And so for Fisk, he's got this idea of culture, and he says, culture is the constant process of producing meanings of and from our social experience. So just like Duguay, Fisk sounds just like Duguay, right? And he says, and such meanings necessarily produce a social identity for the people involved. So he's saying, you know, listen, we're always producing these meanings, and these meanings produce our social identity. He goes on, he says, meanings can circulate only in relationship to the social system, so we have to be surrounded by other people. But he says, in our case, this system is one of white patriarchal capitalism, right? So what he's doing here is he's making a bit of a Marxist kind of critique of American society. Now, this was during, I think he wrote this during the 1980s. So, I mean, this is 40 years ago, right? But he says it's essentially, you know, white people are in charge, men are in charge, and it's a capitalist system. So from there he goes and he says, any social system needs a cultural system, meaning that serves to hold in place, to hold it in place, rather, or destabilize it, or to make it more or less amenable to change. So what he's saying here is that if you're going to have a culture, you have to have a kind of system of meanings. And this, you know, this is made manifest, again, in tradition, in rituals, and in institutions, right? And he says, he goes on and says, culture is a constant succession of social practices, and is therefore inherently political. So the social is political, so it's inherently political, and is centrally involved in the distribution and possible redistribution of power. So again, what Fisk is doing is making a kind of Marxist argument. Marx is interested in flows of power as they relate to people's material existence in society. And so social practices within a culture perpetuate that culture. Right? It's the social practices that where meaning is exchanged. It's meaning that makes culture and sustains it, lets it carry on. And he says, then if this is the case, then culture is about power, right? And the messages that and social practices in culture are about power, about maintaining the system with some people in charge, some people are, you know, workers, some people are essentially kind of serfs or peasants, right? And that the social practices are what keeps this going. Okay, so then he gets on to popular culture. And this is interesting. So here, this is the part that I really wanted you to pay attention to. Popular culture is made by various formations of subordinated or disempowered people out of the resources, both discursive and material, that are provided by the social system that disempowers them. It is therefore contradictory and conflictual to its core. So what Fiske is saying here, if we unpack this, is he's not talking about culture now. He's talking about what we know as popular culture, right? So this is your Taylor Swift and, you know, all the kinds of things, memes and so on. This is all the kind of stuff that falls under the banner of popular culture. Not the old definitions of culture anymore, right? But this is the stuff that we, you know, the celebrities read about in People magazine, the stuff that you see highlighted, you know, in your TikTok feed and so on. So popular culture, he says, is made by various formations of subordinated or disempowered people. So this is interesting because he's saying, listen, popular culture isn't made by the elites that are out there, you know, running the movie studios or running the television stations, right? It's made by the people. And, you know, in a society where 1% of the population controls over 90% of the wealth, you know, this is, so he's talking about the 99% when he's talking about the disempowered people. And he says they make popular culture out of the discursive and material resources. So discursive meaning things like books and movies and so on, as well as material objects that are produced by the social system that disempowers them. So it's the elites that are churning out all the kind of discursive material, right? It's the elites that make the movies, that produce the websites, that make the news, and so on. But it's the people who decide then what's popular. And in this sense, it's contradictory, right? Because it's the very society that keeps 99% of its people disempowered to a certain extent. It's the same society that empowers them to create what is popular. So to sort of explicate this point, he says the resources are controlled by the dominant, so the dominant class of society. But if the cultural commodities or texts do not contain resources out of which people can make their own meanings of their social relations and identities, so in other words, they got to be able to produce commodities or movies or films or books that give people resources where they can create their own identity, right? And if they don't do this, then it'll get rejected and it'll fail in the marketplace. They will not become popular. So then he says, popular culture is made by subordinated people in their own interests out of resources that also contradictorily serve the economic interests of the dominant. So what he's saying here is that the dominant classes, the elites, the one percenters, got to create these texts, right, let's call them, that the subordinated people, the other 99%, can look at and sort of create their own meanings out of them and use those meanings to, in part, to create their identities, right, and use it to their own ends, right, to serve their own interests. But what's contradictory about this is that in doing so, they're keeping the one percenters in charge, right? They're empowering the system that is disempowering them. So he sees this as a conflictual kind of thing, right? Oh man, it took away my example. So I'll see if I can find it here in a minute. But he says popular culture is always a culture of conflict. It always involves the struggle to make social meanings that are in the interest of the subordinate, and that are not those preferred by the dominant ideology. So even though it's the dominant class that's creating these, you know, and marketing these texts, it's the disempowered people that are making them popular. And so again, there's this conflict there. And so what happens is that popular culture regularly resists or evades the structures of dominance. And so let's see if this will take me to YouTube. And so this is the example.
Does having a 4.0 GPA matter?
Fuck me, this goddamn...
6 to 12th grade parents. We're going to expose
I need to put
the college admissions
ad blocker on here. But this is their example, right?
Right about now, NWA court is in full effect. Judge Dre residing. In the case of NWA versus the police department, prosecuting attorneys are MC Ren, Ice Cube, and Easy motherfucking E. Order, order, order.
thing.
Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help your black ass?
You goddamn right.
Won't you tell everybody what the fuck you gotta say?
Fuck the police, coming straight from the underground. A young nigga got it bad, cause I'm brown.
All right, so you get the idea, right? I mean, this is exactly what Fisk is talking about here, which is this contradiction in popular culture. So, you know, the record company, you got this record company that's worth, you know, presumably billions of dollars, right, that's run by cultural elites, but it creates this product that resists or evades the structures of dominance, right? I mean, fuck the police is clearly not a dominant message. This isn't the message that the people who run society in theory, right, want sent out. But it's, nevertheless, it's a cultural artifact that at least was a piece of popular culture back, you know, when I was a kid during the late 80s, early 90s, right? So this shows you how contradictory this is, right? Oh, and it looks, let's see, okay, good. So from there, Fisk goes on and he talks a little bit about, he talks a little bit about text. And what he's talking about here, you know, and again, a text doesn't have to be like a piece of writing or a book. It could be a movie, it could be a painting, whatever. But he's talking about activated texts. And I'll give you, I might as well dig in here. So he says, texts are activated when they're engaged with. And then he goes on, he says, open texts are the most easily activated. So what he's saying here, right, is a text, if it's, you know, if a movie's just sitting there and nobody watches it, it's not activated. In order for it to be, you know, really do something, somebody's got to engage with it. So you got to pick up the book to activate it. You got to watch the movie to activate it. And then he says, open texts are the most easily activated. So what he means by open isn't like the book is open. What he means is that an open text, in theory, right, in communication theory, an open text is a text that can be interpreted in a lot of different ways, right? A closed text is a text that can only be interpreted in one or two ways that fights the idea that you can make other meanings out of it, right? So he says, listen, you know, to share meanings, texts have to be activated. And open texts have the most meanings and therefore the most easily activated. So an open text, an allegory, right? Something that I can read and interpret in one way and you can read and interpret in another. So then he goes on, texts only make sense in relation to other texts and in their social uses, right? So what he's saying here, again, goes back to that idea that we got with Duguay, right? So that, you know, a Western only makes sense in some regard, based on all the other Westerns you've seen. So he goes on, he says, the meanings of popular culture only exist in their circulation, not in their texts. So, in other words, if nobody listened to Fuck the Police, then there's no meaning there, right? The meaning only exists to the extent that it's circulated, that the text gets out, that the song gets out, a lot of different people can listen to it, right? So, circulation, right, is key for meaning to exist. Your message has to get in front of people, right? So the meanings of popular culture only exist in their circulation, not in their texts, which are crucial in this process. Texts need to be understood not for and by themselves, but in their interrelationships with other texts and with social life, for that's how their circulation is ensured. Right, so if someone like Fisk was going to study N.W.A. right in that album, they're going to look at that in terms of the history of 80s rap. He's going to look at it in terms of how it circulated, the marketing around it, the company that's doing it, how it's being circulated, who's buying it, who's listening to it, right, and so on and so forth, to figure out how that meaning is actually made. And so here's another example that I found. This is an older video here, but it certainly gives you an idea about this concept of intertextuality and how some texts only make sense in relation to other texts and their social uses. So this is the Black Widow, the Black Widow video starring Iggy Azalea and Rita Ora. So let's check this out for a second. It's kind of silly, by the way.
Welcome to Big Wanda's.
Hi.
Would you like to hear the special?
No, not really, because I kind of already know what I want, okay?
What would you like?
A bacon sandwich with cheese.
Sure.
Like a lot of cheese, okay? Like melted cheese, extra like cheese. Dripping off of it. Yeah. That's right.
By the way, and I
she's going to have the same damn thing, aren't you? Yeah.
Two BLTs, extra cheese, coming up.
Well, make it snappy, because I'm late, all right?
Well, I'm sorry.
Why don't you go get it?
Get the order right.
Just go
yes,
get
sir.
It.
All right.
Why'd you always have to be so loud?
I just want a sandwich, all right?
All right, so I'm going to fast forward a little bit.
BLT, extra cheese?
Called a Wanda special. It's a big old thing. All of us. You know what? You don't have to pay for anything. She don't have to pay for hers.
So that's probably enough. Again, I told you, it's a little silly, right? So, but this is about intertextuality. Text only makes sense in relation to other texts, right? So then, what other texts are being referenced in that video? Well, first off, we got Michael Madsen, right? So Kill Bill, Quentin Tarantino, Michael Madsen, the actor who appears in the beginning of this in the diner, right? We have the outfits that Iggy Azalea and Rita Ora are wearing. They're clearly derivative of the outfit that Uma Thurman wears in Kill Bill. We have the sword fight out in the snow in the cherry orchard. We have Iggy Azalea or Rita Ora, I forget which one, riding the motorcycle just like Uma Thurman, right? We have female assassins looking to kill somebody the same way we have the female assassins in Kill Bill. Right, we have the diner scene that's reminiscent of Tarantino again with Pulp Fiction and of course Reservoir Dogs. We have the presence of Paul Sorvino, who of course is a famous actor who's appeared in countless gangster movies, including Scorsese's Goodfellas. We have the whole idea of the mob style poker game, which is a trope that we see in all kinds of gangster films, including again Goodfellas. We have the presence of T.I., right? Because he, of course, was at one time Iggy Azalea's mentor. And we understand that video then in the context of every other thing T.I. has done and all the information that we possess about T.I. We understand the video in terms of all that we understand of all the gangster movies we've ever seen, all the Tarantino movies we've ever seen, all the movies that we've seen these actors and actresses in, the kinds of clothes that they wear, and so on. It all then influences the way that we engage with that video, right? Or at least that's the idea that Fisk has in some sense. So then he goes on and he says, popular texts can ensure their popularity by making themselves terrains for social struggle. So in other words, you know, it's the people who make things popular. So give the people something that, you know, that they can make popular, right? Make it a terrain of social struggle. Put a bunch of different messages in there, right? Texts are only complete when they provoke meaning and pleasure. And indeed, he says, things only become relevant when they're the site of struggle, right? Pop culture is structured within what Stuart Hall calls the opposition between the power block and the people, right? So it's contradictory. It's largely produced, or at least it used to be entirely produced, by cultural elites and institutions, but it's made popular by the people, so there's that contradiction. And he says economic power, the power of the institutions that put out these texts, is only superseded and achieved by semiotic power, the power to make meaning. So the dominant class can put all this stuff out there, but unless the rest of us, the 99%, are able to make meanings out of the text, it won't become popular. And so he says then semiotic resistance, if we do want to resist the dominant power structures, then semiotic resistance, this meaning-making, you know, that's what he's talking about when he's talking about semiotics, this meaning-making can be a real site of resistance, right? And I'm gonna skip the clip here at the end because I've gone a little long. But nevertheless, hopefully you get kind of an idea about what these folks were talking about, and these lectures help to clarify the readings a little bit. As always, if you have any questions about them, shoot me an email. I'm happy to respond. Okay, thanks for checking out my video.